our experience.
Let me say that again. This is the Laurette Taylor experience. Assembled on my stage left side are a series of stations. They're ordered from A through F. They could represent a historical biographical timeline. They could be an emotional journey. They could represent a movement sequence. For me, they're components to the work that we're building, which is a Laurette Taylor experience. Station A, space. The space that we're in right now, and we all have a very particular relationship to this space. This is one of my favorite spaces, actually. I love the white floor. I love these big red columns. It's specifically designed for the kind of theater that's made here. Your relationship to this space, I was thinking about this today, your relationship to this space began in a formal kind of way when you bought your ticket. Because you decided that you were going to be here tonight at 8 o'clock at Theater of Eugen, at the corner of Florida and Mariposa. Station B is a rehearsal skirt, a piece of text from the Grass Menagerie. Laurette Taylor was the first actor to play Man in the Wayne Field, the mother of the play. Station C is a set of photo stills, also for Laurette in the Glass Menagerie. She's doing one of the telephone speeches. Here the idea is that you choose three gestures and try to replicate them with as much precision as possible. The idea being that gesture plus time can create story, emotional journey, kind of like all the other stations. Station D is dialogue on a loop. In this particular case, it's a conversation between Laurette and her husband, the playwright Harvey Manners, when he's dying. Station E, this black table with a jewelry box right here, there's a set of pearls inside, and there's a movement sequence that is done on 26 taps. It was developed by Stanislavski and Laurette when they were in rehearsal for The Mistress of the Inn. Station F, way up there, is a piece of text, a war bonds commercial. The idea here is to play with language. And for me, I kind of do it in a technical way, so I'm really playing with the shape of the sounds as they come out of my mouth, how they move through time and interact with the space. And without further ado, we will get started.
truth, Mr. Manners.
Tell my girl it will be a long time before I see her again. Murder! Help! Murder!
Miss Taylor! Miss Taylor!
Come with me, Lord. Come with me. Lori, come with me. You don't always speak the truth, but tell my girl the truth now.
What truth, Mr. Manners?
Tell my girl it will be a long time before I see her again. Murder! Help! Murder!
Miss Taylor! Miss Taylor!
Come with me, Lori. Come with me. Lori, come with me. You don't always speak the truth, but tell my girl the truth now.
What truth, Mr. Manners?
Tell my girl it will be a long time before I see her again.
It's a real problem.
Thank you. Station B.
Laura.
Station A.
What?
Station A.
I used to get all tight and tense before a performance. Then Hartley would come to my dressing room, and he would say, "You've got money, love, and fame. Nothing anybody thinks about what you do out there tonight matters. Go out there and charm."
Station F.
So that the world may one day, and God grant that that be soon, be free and safe and happy by a bond. By a war bond, right now. I shall be here at circle 64343, waiting for you to call me. In memory of those boys I knew in London, in those dreadful days of the last war,
Station D.
I just can't keep doing this.
I'm gonna do this.
In those dreadful days of the last war.
Miss Taylor.
And in dedication to those boys who today are in the Pacific and the Atlantic, in the Arctic, in the desert, in the mountains, who are giving so much more than we can ever repay.
Time.
So we're going to dive into audience feedback, I think. Yeah. I'm Rebecca. I'm the dramaturg for the students.
I loved listening to it.
Specifically at War Bonds? Or?
War Bonds, yes. And the drinking.
The length of time of a shot and how much liquid you're pouring into the glass tells, how quickly you shoot it tells, how much you stare at it before you drink it, the sound of the glass on the table. I think with like a station B with the three gestures, that thinking about how that one repeated sequence just done slightly differently tells you a totally different thing. Yeah.
Any other impressions, memories? And
They can be one word, or they can be whole sentence. Yes?
I was, like, on the edge of my seat about to stand up because I thought that that was sort of an invitation. I was super uncomfortable, actually. I thought that you guys had sort of were eliciting that. And I was looking around very uncomfortably, sort of thinking that these were stations for the audience. So just sort of like a scene, you know, like, I guessed about it because I was like, oh my gosh, I'm going to get wasted.
Well, I'm going to go on order and segue to
So was I the only one?
No.
No.
Who was show of hands? Who wanted to come into a station?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Who felt invited to come into a station? Who was disappointed that they didn't get to do a station? Great.
Yeah.
So there's a number of ways that the stations might be used.
One of the things we had initially set up with the idea that one night I was just going to drink. And then I would come out, I would explain what the stations were, which I did. And then the other two nights, we had this idea in mind. Because it is the Laurette Taylor experience, we wanted to give you an experience. And so we were going to turn over control to the audience of, this is actually home, and this is the station. So you could call out letter A, B, C, D, E, or F. And that was kind of how we were going to play it. One night we were going to bring out two people from the audience and they would control it. The other night we were going to do the director, two people from the audience. The third night we're just gonna, it would be a free-for-all. But we had an emergency, and so the director couldn't be here, and we felt we really needed her to be able to manage that. So we had, kind of had to rethink what we were doing. I really liked that you felt that invitation.
Yeah.
You've also talked about the stations could happen simultaneously, they could overlap, and that sort of thing. I don't know, does anyone have any urges to see the station happen all at once, or see one person go through that, or anything specific in that regard?
I feel like it could be in a house, and there could be many Brett Taylors, and you could walk through and experience them however you want to. Maybe you're drinking too, and then or I feel like it could be the kind of thing where you walk around and experience it as a sort of self-imposed, like you become Laurette Taylor and you sit down and do the war bonds and they're like art installations. So I think there's a lot of ways you can play with space and your audience's interaction with her.
Yes.
For
me, I don't know who Laurette Taylor is. So explaining all the stations didn't make sense to me, and for me it would have made more sense for you to explain who she was and then to have done each station without explaining what the stations were. But I don't
did
know
you who get we're kind of aware that there isn't a lot of context. Did anyone have like inklings or emotions about Loretta? I didn't know who she was before this either.
So
just like did anything come out like alcohol? But anything else like that?
I mean, the context of the first person playing Van Wingfield was like, you know, you originate a role, you bring something of yourself to it, and everybody thinks of, who knows, Class Menagerie knows that she's this sort of, hopeless, she's this sad woman who has these false dreams about what her daughter is. And so to see a woman who owned drinking sets it up in a certain context, you think of it as, you know, this is the woman who played a Michele Talgarow first. And that brought context to it for me.
And in that way.
I have questions about, does Laurette Taylor have a connection to actually this space? So I was confused at whether it was you that had a connection to this space or whether Laurette Taylor has a connection. I didn't know if she was local, when she was alive. And I wanted the invitation or non-invitation to be more clear. I really like the use of the die. I thought perhaps that could be extended to the audience if you wanted them to participate. Here, you have a chance to roll, to choose what station it is, or you call out station 5, and if no one moves, maybe then that's more clearly an invitation for us to go to station 5.
You just solve their problems.
Yeah.
Just handing someone to die and letting them hold that. We spend so much time talking to the audience and thank you.
So I had kind of a comment question about the structure. So I saw it on Wednesday also and today, and it was approached differently with the structure. On Wednesday, you just started with station F and just went for it and then explained everything after, whereas this one, everything was explained up front. And my comment was that with not explaining, I didn't have any context, so I didn't really know what was going on, so I felt really lost. And then with this one, I felt like I almost had too much context because I knew exactly what was going to happen. So I feel like what I would have appreciated was maybe like saying this is the Laurette Taylor project and maybe giving like a one word description for each thing. Like this one's space, this one is movement or something. So I as the audience wouldn't know what was going to happen, but I had like some kind of inkling that something would.
Yeah.
Because what was interesting on Wednesday was sitting there trying to figure out what was going on. So I kind of like, I was like, oh, she's saying, it took me a few times to be like, she's saying the same thing over and over again, and it's changing. So that was kind of an experience going along with it, where I was going in knowing it kind of lost that
development. That was a, Nicholas,
and then I have a question about the structure. There was a lot of context given for the stations along the way, but then didn't know what to expect with the drinking, but then the drinking, it seemed like, was actually maybe leading towards taking up the entire time. So how much of the time did you anticipate being there versus the stations? Because I know we didn't actually get enough time for all the stations.
Excellent question. We had 10 minutes. You know, and we really tried to build the piece within the context of Fury, or Fractured Parts, and Work in Progress, and you have 10 minutes. And so, you know, the drinking, I've done it for like 20 minutes to half an hour and in rehearsal. We knew we couldn't do that, so we kind of had to make these sort of compromises as to how we showed it. And then we started thinking about, well, we have, in total, we have 30 minutes. So over the course of each evening, what can we present? And how can we, because there's specific feedback that we actually need from the audience in terms of, so, in the way that we continue forward, because it is an experience. And so, you know, the way that, like, the feedback we've gotten this week has really shaped what happened tonight.
And we are approaching that. So I just want to, you can keep talking along with the lines that we have been talking, but I'd also like to ask, what was it like to watch that for so long? Would you want it to go on longer?
That was exactly what I was about to say, was that my question to you is, what are you wanting to elicit from the audience? And then I wanted to tell you that my experience was extremely, not just awkward, uncomfortable, but incredibly sad. When you were sitting there drinking, I was so uncomfortable watching you go through that. And it felt like I could put a lot of story into that, whatever, but just that was very uncomfortable. And then hearing audience members around me start to laugh made me even more terrified and uncomfortable, because I was not experiencing that as humorous at all. So I don't know if that's part of what you were...
The drinking is something we're exploring. You know, and it's when her husband died, that was a big thing for her. And she went into mourning for 10 years and she gave herself over to alcoholism. And so, to me, in making this piece, that feels important. And because I'm not going to give myself over to alcoholism, you know, and the audience, you know what I mean? Like, this is a rehearsal. Kind of thing. How can we give the audience the sense of, wow, she's really invested in this? Mm-hmm. And so it feels to me like it's important that she drank for a period of time. And we can look at different ways that drinking happens, because especially in this time period, there was such a social element to it that a lot of people were alcoholics and you weren't even know it because they're functioning, and it was just part of the culture. But there, in exploring the history, you see these bumps where, wow, this particular moment is really awkward and uncomfortable. And that's what I'm interested in. You know, I'm interested in exploring that and how can we all go to that moment and be uncomfortable with this.
And let's please continue this conversation.
Oh. I think we do cover like one more.
Burning question. Yeah. I was going to say, seeing it the first time on whenever the day was, there was a story behind the drinking. I mean, if that's all I had seen. But when I saw it today, it was different because I got the explanation. So as its own installation, I was in a journey. I felt like I could hear what she was thinking. It was sad. I mean, I knew there was a lot of story behind it. I loved getting the text. So I was just envisioning that seeing the drinking first and then have the explanation and then the stage, something like that. But that really got me, it really moved me the first time. And I wasn't as moved the second time because I'd seen it, but I was really moved. I was almost like speechless. I was just completely like, a person's whole life was told.
Kind of humorous or no, it was enthralling.
Yeah, it was enthralling.
Hearing the recording, that's
up. Yeah.
Yes. Let's keep talking as we interface.